It's time for Speed 77 Radio's Motor Sports Madness, powered by the staff at Race Chaser Online. Today's racing news, yesterday's racing history. And now, here are your hosts, Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
And good evening, race fans, and welcome back. We hope you've had a restful holiday. I know we have, and we're glad to be back here on the Performance Motorsports Network. We got a lot to talk about over the next 2 hours, and we'll get to that right now. First off, though, good evening. My name is Jacob Seelman, regular host of Motorsports Madness, alongside my Race Chaser Online colleague and senior editor, Tom Baker. And, you know, just because it's now getting basically to December, Tom, doesn't mean that we're short of news across the news wire. With that being said, we get to scroll back now just a little bit. We did not have a live show on last Monday following the Homestead finales for the three NASCAR National Series. Here's my first question to you tonight. Are you buying or selling that any one of the three champions didn't deserve to sit where they sat based on the way the cards fell? And go.
Am I buying or selling that any of them didn't deserve it?
Correct.
I'm selling, or I'm buying that they didn't.
Okay.
Wait a minute. See, you confused. Let me just explain it this way. I think they all deserved it.
Okay.
I think all of them were very deserving. under the Thanksgiving situation, honestly, it really comes down to, being thankful for what you have. And I think each of those three champions should be thankful for what they have and what they earned, because all of them did earn it. I mean, we can sit here all day and we can talk about the various and sundry, situations with regard to, okay, I like this format, I don't like that format, whatever. The fact is that all three champions did what was required of them under the format that was laid out for them. And I think they should all be proud of themselves. Kyle Busch obviously was absolutely remarkable in his comeback. And again, we can have a discussion about the chase format, about, the situation that allowed him to be where he was. And everybody has a different opinion about that, and that's fine. But under the systems that were there, Kyle Busch and Chris Buescher, and I don't think anyone is going to take away anything from Erik Jones.
Heck,
I mean,
no.
The kid was just phenomenal.
He really was. I mean, let's stop and break each of these down for a second, Tom, because we didn't really get a good chance to do that, of course, prior to the Thanksgiving holiday. Let's start at the truck level, because gosh darn, I know we all knew at the beginning of this year that Erik Jones was going to be a potential superstar, but he met my expectations and then exceeded them with the way he performed and the way he kept his poise under pressure all season long. I said it when I finally saw him run a tripleheader weekend, the Texas weekend after Matt Kenseth's suspension was upheld, that I said he was the real deal, and I stand by that statement. I believe it. I'm excited to see him move up next year with a championship in hand, because this boy is taking NASCAR right now by storm.
Well, yes, he is, and I think more importantly than that, he's got great backing behind him. I mean, not only did he develop into a very headsy driver as the season went on, and a driver who really relaxed in terms of the emotional side of things. He kept his emotions in check. Really, after Charlotte was when he started to really relax and kind of keep himself a little bit more even keeled. And when he started doing that, the performances came right up there, and he had a spectacular second half of the season and looked good in anything he was in, whether it was Truck Xfinity or Cup. And so I think he really kind of embraced Kyle Busch and his mentorship And as Kyle relaxed and kind of changed his demeanor, I think Erik Jones followed that lead. And I think that's what's going to make him a very quick success in Xfinity next year. He's got, you know, the best program going in Xfinity behind him, unless you want to talk about Penske. Junior Motorsports did not have the level of performance this year that they're used to. For the most part, I mean, Regan Smith and Chase Elliott both contended for the title, but, you know, really when you look at the Chase contenders themselves and you look at their overall record, Jacob, they were definitely, none of them were spectacular. They were all good enough. And of course, with the Cup guys coming in and stealing the top two or three or four spots, a lot of times it was hard to, you know, to get great finishes, but even the number of top fives that each of them had and top tens was about the same. So, I think Erik Jones is going to come in and have tremendous success next year very quickly as a full-time Xfinity racer. And it wouldn't surprise me to see him be one and done and be up in Cup in 2017 if there's an opportunity within the organization.
Furniture Row.
Well, again, yeah. I mean, there's an opportunity within the Toyota organization to put him in a good situation, and he's ready. I wouldn't be surprised to see that at all.
Can I throw you what I heard?
Is this a rumor?
Well, it's a rumor that's far more substantial than anything else I've heard recently.
Okay.
Okay, kids, this is what I've heard for next year. Rumor has it that there will be a second Furniture Row car for at least a portion of the season, split between Erik Jones for the 7 races he can run to keep his rookie eligibility, and wait for it, Daniel Suarez, and discuss.
With Furniture Row?
Yeah, it would be
a second
split.
Car.
It would be the second car would be split between 7. It wouldn't be a full season car, but like 6 or 7 for Erik and maybe 6 or 7 for Suarez.
That's interesting.
I'll tell you the catalyst for that deal too. Aris wants a Mexican-born driver in the Cup Series somehow, some way in the not too distant future.
Well, then that probably you would have to think would take away the rumor that was kind of floating around out there that Regan Smith possibly back to Furniture Row in a second car, unless they're going to go to a second full-time car and a third part-time car, which would seem to be a bit of a stretch at this point, unless there's already enough outside, corporate funding in order to, we know Aris, you just said, with the part-time car, but we don't know what's working with Regan. So I would tend to think if that situation appears to have legs, then I would tend to think that maybe the Regan situation doesn't, which still leaves him without a full-time opportunity for
I'll
next year.
I'll offer again the 9 car.
Yeah, still hearing David Reagan, and I've also heard Ryan Truex, which is, you know, both of them I would think are plausible. Obviously David Reagan has the experience and certainly would probably be about anybody's first choice in terms of somebody steady to get the job done. And, Ryan Truex is a young driver who I would really like to see in Cup because I think he certainly has the talent to be there. If you put him in top equipment, I think he'll learn to race it there. But Regan is worthy as well. So other than that, there's not really too much available in the Cup Series unless a ride gets invented that doesn't exist at this point. So you'd have to think that Regan's situation is tenuous at best at this point. But I do know that Furniture Row wants to be a 3-car team. I don't know that they wanted to be a 3-car team in 2016, but maybe the stars will align for them to be able to do that. That's a lot of growth from 1 to 3 all at once. So 1 to 1.5 or, you know, thereabouts, as you're talking about, is a little bit of an easier adjustment.
Yeah, it is a much easier adjustment. Now, I shuffle to the Xfinity series because we can tie this in a little bit as well as far as drivers who may end up in the Cup Series at some point, if not next year. Chris Buescher didn't really know what he was doing during all of the champion festivities and all that, whether he'd be back to defend his title, whether he might not potentially be doing something in the Cup Series next year in a car, not really sure which one. It's a whole twisted mess potentially for him. It's going to be interesting to see, where do you see Chris Buescher ending up for 2016, especially with the rumor that Front Row Motorsports is going to shift over to Chevrolet, become one of the RCR affiliated teams, and basically all of a sudden leave Roush Fenway without an affiliate team in the Cup Series besides RPM, which makes me go,
That was a nice sound effect. I like that.
I'm good at those.
Yeah, you are good at those. I don't see Chris Buescher being in the Cup Series next year at all. I would think that if Chris Buescher's anywhere, he would be back in the Xfinity Series. I have heard some conversation, people kind of wondering, well, you know, how long does Ricky Stenhouse get before, you know, he either finally improves his performance or, you know, the team decides that he just doesn't have winning ability in the Cup Series. I'm not sure what to make of that because I know Ricky's past pedigree. He's been a winner all the way up to that point. He just has never really in the Cup Series shown a lot. Although
outside
right now,
Talladega.
Yeah. Although Roush really, as a whole in the Cup Series the last couple of years, hadn't shown a lot. Greg Biffle's had a few highlights, but you know they kind of have to reach to get them. So I don't know. I don't know how to deal with that except to say that I think right now the best chance Chris Buescher has in 16 is to come back and defend. You know, Jack's got one or two other people in the pipeline that certainly, you know, are potentials.
Kyle Weatherman.
Yeah, I mean, you can't ignore Kyle Weatherman.
No.
I think we kind of know what he's doing, do we not?
Kind of, sort of, ish.
Ish, you know, ish. So I think that his best bet is going to be probably the Xfinity Series to defend the title and, you know, wait to see what happens with the Roush Cup program, because I don't see them going to a fourth car. I really don't, not unless the funding is there to do it.
Exactly. And we'll talk the Cup side of this equation on the other side. So around the turn, we've got more Motorsports Madness right here on PMN. You are listening to the Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports.
Dad, remember that year my birthday party got washed out by the storm when nobody showed up? And we spent the whole night eating cake and ice cream.
Yeah, I remember. Had to be your worst party ever.
Actually, it was my favorite.
You never know which moments will be the ones they remember forever. So take time to be a dad today. Learn more at 1-877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov.
Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this could be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
The Performance Motorsports Network is a compilation of shows about motorsports. From technical to controversial to just fun, everything you like about racing and gearhead stuff is right here on one internet channel. The Performance Motorsports Network. Tell your friends about it.
Hi, this is Denny Hamlin. I want to share with you today a little-known but widely pervasive neurological disorder called dyspraxia. It's estimated that dyspraxia affects between 4 and 10% of the general population, and the majority of those affected are male. The condition primarily affects motor skills, but also can affect memory, judgment, and executive function. It's sometimes referred as the hidden disability because it's not immediately obvious to others that the person affected has special needs. My niece Sarah has dyspraxia, and with the proper support in place, she is very successful in school and other activities. Sarah was lucky because she was diagnosed early. Many children and adults go years without knowing. Let's raise awareness for this disability that affects 1 in 11 people. I encourage you to learn more, get involved, and support the Dyspraxia Foundation USA. Thank you.
They'll challenge your authority. They'll try to break your will. They'll push you to the edge of your sanity. Because that's what kids do. But this car is your territory, not theirs. Defend it. Who makes the payments? Who cleans it? Who drives it? You do. That's who. And in here, your word is law. So when you say you won't move until everyone's buckled up, you won't budge an inch until you hear that click. Never give up until they buckle up. A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council. For more information, visit safercar.gov/kidsbuckleup.
We now return you to 2.5 Men on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
And welcome back to the madness here on PMN. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker with you. Kyle Magda is off this evening, and we are discussing champions as we start to move into the winter months and move into the off season. And Tom, we were talking trucks and Xfinity before the break. Let's talk a little Cup Series action right now. And you give me your opinion on the comeback kid that is Kyle Busch. We've all agreed on the fact that, you know, more than 150 NASCAR National Series victories and an Xfinity title and 3 owners' titles, make it 4 owners' titles now in the Truck Series, without a Cup championship was one heck of a resume. He adds the Cup championship to his resume, and in my opinion, pretty well completes it. But gosh, he did it this year in the most unbelievable, improbable of circumstances. And at the end of the day, if it wasn't Jeff Gordon, I love this story.
Well, I love the story, and I believe that Kyle is every bit deserving. You know, we get caught up sometimes in, well, he only ran half a season or whatever it was. He doesn't deserve to win the championship. If we were doing points under the old system, that wouldn't have happened. Well, we're not doing points under the old system. And if we were doing points under the old system last year, Kevin Harvick doesn't win the title. And I don't think anybody would have argued that when Kevin Harvick won the last race at Homestead last year, that Kevin was not a deserving champion. The fact is that Kyle spotted the competition 11 races, still won more than every single one of them, except for Joey Logano, and probably accumulated more points in the last 25 races or whatever the number was, than, you know, anybody else did to get, you know, where he was. So he more than qualified himself. Sometimes championships are about more than just, well, I got the most points because I ran around and finished fifth the most or whatever. That's just, to me, that's not what a championship is. I think Kyle Busch had a spectacular 25 race season or whatever it was that he ran. You know, I think he's every bit as deserving. That the rules were laid out, he exceeded the qualifications by a country mile. You know, and more than that, Kyle grew off the track this year tremendously. I mean, I think, you know, his issues, his wife's issues, the birth of their son, having racing kind of taken away from him for the first time, it really matured him in a way that nobody could have probably expected, Jacob. And I have told people since the end of the race at Homestead, I think Kyle Busch's best years are probably in front of him. And I think with the way that he's approaching this whole thing mentally now, I think he's going to develop into that phenomenon that everybody expected he was going to be when Rick Hendrick signed him and put him in the 5 car. And, you know, I honestly believe that Kyle Busch and Joey Logano are going to be two of the key faces in the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, you know, for the next 10 to 12 or 15 years, however long, you know, Kyle decides to compete. He's a little older than Joey. But, you know, I think those two are going to be, you know, two of the key figures. And whether anybody likes them or not, they're not going away.
They're not going away, and that's what makes it fun. That's what makes it fun going into next year, too, Tom, because you talk about this championship four that we were discussing. You've got Kyle Busch, who won the championship. You've got Martin Truex, who made it to the championship round. And, oh, by the way, that team, Furniture Row, is teaming up with the team that just won the championship. And I want to go ahead and say that, you know, we've got Kyle Busch, who won a title. Not only do I think he's capable of defending it next year, but I think Martin Truex is capable of doing exactly what he did this year, maybe even at a little bit higher level, not to get away from our championship conversations of this year too quickly, but gosh darn, I was impressed by the job that he did this year, just staying the course like he did, knowing that it was almost a lame duck year in a way.
Well, here again, Martin Truex is another example of a driver who went through a lot of emotion over the last couple of years. Obviously, the whole situation back in 2013 that took him back out of the chase after he'd been in it with MWR. And then last year, having all that go away and, you know, coming over to Furniture Row and, you know, struggling. And this year, he just really, that team looked comfortable. The crew chief that he's got is a very dynamic crew chief, is not afraid to take chances and do things that are a little bit outside of the box. And, you know, really with no help from Chevrolet whatsoever, That team ended up in the final four, and they did it by their own sheer will and I think great chemistry. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you got to believe that the transition to Toyota, and with, you know, full help from JGR, you know, that team's only going to get better. And you know, again, I think honestly, I think Chevrolet, frankly, has made a huge mistake in letting them go. And I think they're going to regret it, to be honest, because I think that mm-hmm. team could have won them a championship. And I will say, faster than Richard Childress Racing is going to win him another championship, with no yeah. disrespect meant to RCR. That Furniture Row team was this close.
They were. And it's going to be big to see how this changes the manufacturer balance of power in 2016. I think that's what's going to make this so interesting to watch. And, of course, then you had Jeff Gordon's final race. Finishes sixth, but he was up there. He led lapped. He was in contention for a portion of it. He went out with honor. He went out with a chance to defend his title. And as he said going into the event, that was all he could have asked for.
Well, and that, he's right. That is all he could have asked for. He's really in a situation where he was in a situation where he had nothing to lose, and just to be able to have a chance to win it. You know, he didn't run as good, obviously, at Homestead as I know he would have liked to have run. He was a bit of a factor early on and then kind of just faded. And he made a comeback at the end of the race, but it was just too little too late. You know, he truly went out on top. I mean, you know, he went out contending for the title, and he went out as a driver who everybody knew could still get it done and win championships if the car was there and the situation was there for him to do it. So Jeff Gordon had nothing to hang his head about. And, you know, it's going to be just odd, Jake, to go into Daytona in February and hear Chase Elliott at the 24 instead of Jeff Gordon. But it's also going to be fun, I think, to still hear and see Jeff Gordon in his new role with Fox, working with Mike Choi and DW. I think that booth's going to be fun.
That booth is going to be fun. I'm excited for the 500 in 16. And speaking of 16, let's go ahead and look down the road a couple of months here. because the big news from Homestead, of course, we already knew, you know, we know what Chase Elliott was doing, but we didn't know until Friday afternoon of Homestead weekend that Ryan Blaney was going to be back full time, though we had thought it was a possibility. The Wood Brothers, the famous 21, back full time with one driver for the first time since 2006, Tom. Between the two of them, Chase Elliott, Ryan Blaney, who performs the best of that duo in 2016 and why?
Ryan Blaney. Because experience. I think Ryan Blaney could possibly contend for the championship next year.
You went there.
I did go there. I think he's and now again with the current Chase format, he doesn't have to go out and win five or six races. He just has to be. I mean, look at Martin Truex. I think Ryan Blaney has the opportunity to contend for the to be a chase car, and I think he's got again Penske's support, and I think how special would that be to see the Wood Brothers in that situation again after all these years going back to. What probably David Pearson for crying out loud in the 70s, maybe Neil Bonnet. But it's been a long time since they've contended for a championship. So I think Blaney and I think Chase Elliott will do okay. But I don't expect Chase Elliott to be, Jeff Gordon or I'm sure he's.
Does he contend to make the chase?
I'm not going to go there with Chase yet. I'm just not. It depends how quickly he and that team gel. If they gel early enough for the season, yeah. Do I think either one of those two could win a race and get in because they won? Well, sure. So in that sense, I think they both could contend. But if we're talking about a season-long consistency of performance, I'm taking Ryan Blaney and giving him the better shot to points in than Chase Elliott. But sure, either one of them are capable of winning a race, and that's all it really takes to get in.
Fair enough. I like it, and I also think I'm going to like a whole lot more the next couple weeks starting to get into what we think is going to happen in 2016. I think that's going to be the most fun discussion to have because there's still some pieces left to be decided. Right now, though, we're headed to a break, and when we come back, we're shifting gears and going to the open wheel side of life. Joel Sebastianelli returns to us to talk Abu Dhabi. And we get to break down the final race of the Formula One season, break down some changes in IndyCar. Yes, there are some drivers in new places going into next year, and we'll talk about it when we come back. You are listening to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
Getting your child home safely.
Tap your heels together three times.
It's just a click away.
There's no place like home.
But making sure your child is in the right seat is just one of the steps down the road to safer travels.
I don't know how it works.
Find the right seat for your little one's age and size. There's no better way to get home safely. Know for sure that your child is in the right seat.
How can I ever thank you enough?
Get all the facts at safercar.gov/the right seat. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
You're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network, your authority on motorsports of all types. Be listening for the most accurate and up-to-the-minute coverage of every motorsports activity that you enjoy on a daily basis. Be it NASCAR, be it IRL, be it Formula One, be it drag racing, be it dirt track, off-road, props, hulls, whatever. We are your source for motorsport. Performance Motorsports Network.
Attention men under the age of 35. You know what really impresses the ladies? When a guy has a few drinks and later gets pulled over for buzz driving. That could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. There goes let's grab dinner and a movie. Oh, I know. You drive more carefully when you're buzzed. You've proven that hundreds of times. A woman admires that kind of confidence. And you've practiced how to speak if a cop does pull you over. Slowly, clearly, and politely, like, "Good evening, officer." A woman admires that kind of foresight. And what woman doesn't find it adorable that you call it buzzed even though the law calls it drunk? You could kiss $10,000 goodbye, along with any chance of having a girlfriend. Because nothing says, "I'm a catch," more than a guy who lives in his parents' basement and calls it my place.
Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Parents, your son or daughter has had their license for a while now, but you want to make sure they're prepared for any situation they may face on the road. High school driver's ed doesn't teach them to drive defensively. They need to be prepared for any highway emergency. For less than a month's insurance, and a whole lot less, BSR instructors at Summit Point Motorsports Park in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, will teach your son or daughter how to respond instantly and positively to unexpected situations on the road. BSR's specialized accident avoidance training teaches swerve to avoid maneuvers at highway speeds, ocular driving, which focuses driving attention on ways to avoid accidents, vehicle dynamics and feedback, skid control and skid recovery, threshold braking on straights and progressive braking on curves, and off-road recovery techniques. This is stuff driver's ed simply doesn't teach. So call BSR today, 304-725-8444. Give your kid the skill set needed to drive safely and responsibly on the highway. That's 304-725-8444.
Time now for Open Wheel Central with our resident wine and cheeser, Joe Sebastianelli. Here to pop the cork is Race Chaser Online's managing editor, Jacob Seelman.
We're back, and I'm out of food, and for that, Joel is not happy with me, Tom. This is not a good thing.
Well, I somehow think we'll manage to get through the segment. You can send him some more cheese to go with his wine later.
Well, yeah, the problem is, Joel, you're whining because the season's over, which is a predicament I'm afraid I can't quite help you with, but that does mean there was one more race to talk about. Can we say three-peat to end the year for Nico Rosberg?
Yes, we can, which will, I think, ultimately be overshadowed by the fact that he was outperformed by Lewis Hamilton for the majority of the season. Three races in a row to end the year for Nico Rosberg. Overall, a tally of six victories, which I think would sound great in almost any other season. But Lewis had his number, especially at the beginning of the year. And although there were points where it seemed like Ferrari and Sebastian Vettel and Nico could perhaps make things close, Lewis always had the outcome in his grasp. It wasn't always firm, but he was the leader every step of the way ever since the first race of the season when he picked up a victory in Melbourne. As for the race in Abu Dhabi, good performance by Nico. Nico able to take the pole by fairly significant margin, actually, by 0.3 seconds on the last lap of Q3. He's first, Hamilton second, Kimi Raikkonen, go figure it, one of the races where they don't have champagne on the podium. Poor Kimi stuck with rose water for the finale, but still a nice finish for him and Sebastian Vettel to come all the way from 15th on the grid. Again, it's not the first time this season, moving all the way up to P4, and Sergio Perez rounding out the top five with Force India. Force India and Sergio Perez, two of the great surprises, especially in the latter half of this Formula One season. So I think when we look at the entire year as a whole, to be quite blunt, it was not the best year for Formula One. Actually, no. That's not blunt at all. This was not a very good season for Formula One. To be more diplomatic, I suppose it could be better. There was some great racing mid-pack, which was true in the first half of the race in Abu Dhabi as well. I think heading into 2016, though, it's going to be much more even, especially at the top between Ferrari and Mercedes. We have a lot to look forward to, except the next couple of months with no racing.
Yeah, we do have a lot to look forward to, and one team at least has something to look forward to, being that they'll be back on the grid, Joel. And I want to bring that up just for a second, because we got the news over the weekend that Red Bull has officially confirmed their entry for 2016. They still haven't officially laid the cards on the table saying, okay, this is how we're doing this, but the heavy speculation is it's going to be an unbranded Renault engine with Mario Illion's help as far as, you know, that Ilmor technology that has been so speculated around that camp. Do you like the move? Do you believe the move? What are you thinking on this? Because I know the one good thing is at least we get four cars back on the grid that we might not otherwise have had.
I like it because, as you said, we need those cars on the grid. I don't like the way it's been handled. I think that Red Bull, even from a public relations standpoint, butchered this from the very beginning. Disgraceful to their engine partners, who granted dropped the ball and were nowhere near Ferrari and Mercedes like they need to be in order to perform at the top. I think that there is potential here. I don't know how much. Obviously, anytime you throw names like Gilmore and Mario Ilonen around, it's a name with a lot of history in everywhere from the Indianapolis Motor Speedway to all across racing. And I think that with his partnership, I don't foresee any way that this could be a championship sort of run from Red Bull. I don't know how great the equipment is that they will get from Renault. But then again, why would Renault, even with an unbranded engine, do anything to sabotage or water down that engine, right? If Renault is going to be supplying that team, then you would think it's going to end up being just Red Bull and Toro Rosso who have Renault power, nobody else on the grid. So I would think that if he's going to put his name on something, it's something he's going to be proud of. There's a high ceiling for Red Bull and Toro Rosso, but there's also a very low floor, a floor much lower than they've had since, you could even argue, since this team first started, long before the days of Sebastian Vettel. So I think that there's some potential there. It's a gamble, but it's one they didn't have much of a choice to take simply because they shot themselves in the foot more than once. They ran out of bullets in the gun, and this is all they had left.
Exactly, and I think that's what that's really what we look at now going into 16. Obviously, we expand the grid with the Haas team coming in, and you know, we look at this now going into the new year with 22 cars and two cars still at the top of this grid. Everybody keeps saying that it's Ferrari that is going to have a serious challenge to Mercedes in 16. I still don't buy it until I actually see it with my own eyes, though. So I'll pose you this instead. If we're discounting the prancing horses, Joel, and we look solely at the Nico versus Lewis brawl in the middle of the Mercedes camp, who comes out on top of that fight early in 2016 and why?
Well, I think the odds-on favorite would have to be Lewis Hamilton based on his history the last 2 years. The fact that Lewis did not seem mentally invested in the final three races of the year, I thought. I know he complained after Mexico and after Brazil that Nico was getting some preferential treatment, and I believe him, actually. I think that because of Nico's fight with Sebastian Vettel for second, that was more important to Mercedes. I think there is truth to the fact that they wanted to keep Nico Rosberg happy at the end, so it would make sense for Nico to be the number one driver. But Lewis was out partying. He already had the championship wrapped up. There wasn't much for him to race for at the end of the year because he had already wrapped up another world championship. So I think that Lewis is the number one driver. I don't think that there's going to be a split in the paddock like there would be for, let's say, Schumacher and Barrichello, or Vettel and Weber towards the end of Sebastian Vettel's title run with Red Bull. I don't think that Mercedes will be as frank about one versus two, but I do think that the cars are going to be set up definitely with Lewis in mind. He's won the last two world championships. You need to earn that role in the team, and I don't think that Nico Rosberg has done that, save for a few great performances this season. Lewis has simply has had more. He's had more talent. He's had more consistency. He has had less mistakes, which is the biggest part, because Nico's also thrown away races, like at Circuit of the Americas when he was leading with a few laps to go, overshot the corner like he did at Monza a year ago when the title fight was hanging in the balance. So I think Lewis is definitely the top dog in that team. Nico can hang around, but if Ferrari pressures Mercedes heavily, I think I like Lewis Hamilton's odds more, not just against Sebastian Vettel, but against his own teammate too.
So let me get this straight. Lewis Hamilton was complaining that Nico was getting preferential treatment, but he was out partying and had less to race for because he'd already wrapped up the championship. There's something inconsistent there, and I don't think it's your statements as much as it is. I think the issue that, frankly, I don't think Lewis really cared. And I find that to be a bit disturbing, given that, you know, okay, I won the championship, so I whatever, let Nico have the last three, or I'll complain about preferential treatment, but I'm out partying. What do I care? I won the title. I don't know. I guess, Joel, it for me, this just comes back to my basic complaint about F1. This isn't about winning races. It's about winning a championship. And as far as I'm concerned, if you've got two drivers on a race team, you set the cars up the way each of the two drivers want them set up, and it should be may the best man win. I don't understand this number one and number two thing at all, and maybe I just never will. I don't know why Nico should want to continue in that situation, to be very honest, if that's the case. I never understood Rubens Barrichello putting it up with the whole deal with Schumacher, because it was blatant that he was never going to be allowed to win a race, period. So I don't really know what to respond to that with, other than to say that I think the reason this season was so bad is because Mercedes rules, and I see that not changing at all next year. I think it's going to be a Lewis Hamilton benefit series again. I do agree with you on that point. Regardless of how hard Rosberg tries, I just don't think he's going to have what it takes to do it. And Vettel, I just don't see anybody coming close to Lewis Hamilton right now.
Well, when you look at Nico Rosberg's numbers, let's just put him up against Rubens Barrichello for a minute. First of all, Ferrari and Mercedes, the two best teams in the sport when those guys were there. Why would you want to go anywhere else? First of all, there's the contractual thing. There's timing. It's not as simple as him saying, hey, I want to leave, and then Ferrari scooping him up. For example, you need to have timing with openings, and we know he has the money, we know he has pedigree, but Nico's in, I guess, as good a spot as he could be at the moment. 185 starts for him, 14 victories in his career. When you consider that Rubens started 322 and had 11, so the disparity is not nearly as big as it was with Schumacher and Ferrari. I think your point works better there than it does with Nico, because let's not forget it was only 1 year ago when Nico was neck and neck, nose to nose, wheel to wheel all the way through the year until the very end when he gave it away, not Mercedes. Mercedes, to their credit, was going to let them fight all the way to the end. And Nico Rosberg is the one who made multiple missteps.
Well, I won't disagree with that.
Race. So I think this year, even at the beginning of the year, they were still letting him fight for it. Lewis earned it. He absolutely learned all of it. So I think that Lewis Hamilton's the favorite, not just because of any sort of preferential treatment or anything like that. I think Lewis is the favorite simply because he's the better driver. That's not going to change wherever Nico goes.
Valid point. We're coming back across the pond to talk some IndyCar news and notes right around the turn. You are listening to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. We are the voice of motorsports.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
Today in school, I learned a lot. In chemistry, I learned that no one likes me. In English, I learned that I'm disgusting. And in physics, I learned that I'm a loser.
Today in school, I learned that I'm ugly and useless. And in gym, I learned that I'm pathetic and a joke. In history, I learned that I'm trash.
Today in school, I learned that I have no friends. In English, I learned that I make people sick. And at lunch, I learned that I sit on my own because I smell. In chemistry, I learned that no one likes
me. In biology, I learned that I'm fat and stupid. And in math, I learned that I'm trash.
The only thing I didn't learn in school today...
The only thing I didn't learn today...
The only thing I didn't learn
is why no one ever helps.
Kids witness bullying every day. They want to help, but they don't know how. Teach them how to stop bullying and be more than a bystander at stopbullying.gov. A message from the Ad Council.
Media sales professionals with agency experience. If you're frustrated with your current position, unrealistic quotas, and inept management, if you're a sales machine and you simply will not take no as an acceptable reply, if you're looking for a rapidly growing company with unlimited sales potential for commissions in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, if you're searching for a high-tech, forward-looking, laid-back, but extremely professional organization who appreciate your skills and dedication, we have your next opportunity. Scorpion Radio Group is building a sales team of self-starters who are motivated. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444 or email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. That's 717-749-0444 and ask for Sue.
COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, is a lung disease that robs people of their ability to breathe. As many as 24 million Americans suffer from COPD, also known as chronic bronchitis or emphysema, and half of them don't know they have the disease. If you or someone you love is over 35 and has smoked more than 100 cigarettes in their lifetime, visit driveforcopd.org and take the screener, then take that to your doctor. I'm Jeff Stoltz, and I drive for COPD.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
I'm about to make Joel pay for that comment right here as we come back for round two of Open Wheel Central here on the Performance Motorsports Network and Motorsports Madness. So, Joel, I'll just put it to you like this. Is the news that we got on Friday that Sage Karam was being cut loose from the Ganassi Open Wheel program for 2016 as bad or worse than Snuggies for Dogs, or are you not willing to go that far with it?
Much further. For Ganassi, I don't know how much of a choice they had. Chip Ganassi has done everything he could for Sage, sticking with him for a very long time. This is an IndyCar deal. This is not a Ganassi deal. This is bad news for the series. It goes to show how even top teams like Chip Ganassi Racing cannot afford to bring young drivers on him. This kid is a phenom. He has IndyCar champion written all over him. And now if IndyCar won't get him, then somebody else will. The worst case scenario for Sage Karam would be to not race anywhere this year. I think he knows he can't do that. Whether he goes to race sports cars, whether he, I don't know where else he could go. If something in stock cars pops up, do it. He has to stay in a race car somewhere. It's just so frustrating because I've heard the argument that he bangs up too much equipment. I think that's an overrated argument. I think it's also expected sometimes with young drivers. Look at Max Verstappen. I mean, this kid has Formula One world champion written all over him too. And yes, he's made some mistakes, but there are some mistakes everybody needs to learn on their own, whether it's in a race car or not. It's a part of growing up. It's a part of maturing. IndyCar is at a very intriguing point. Not so much a crossroads, but their talent has stalled out. Zach Beach, who I'm sure we'll get to in a minute, was hailed as being a next-gen IndyCar driver, and then he had trouble finding a ride anywhere after a successful season in Indy Lights. You have an Indy Lights champion, Jack Harvey, who is campaigning for an IndyCar ride, but we don't know whether or not he'll be able to wind up anywhere. And at the top, there's drivers we know and love, but drivers who have been there for a very long period of time. Elio Castroneves, Tony Kanaan. I wonder if it's actually in IndyCar's best interest for some of these drivers who have been around for that long to retire, to move on, because as awful as it sounds, that may be the only way to keep young talent funneling up. As somebody who wants to see the best interest of IndyCar, I think that just in a perfect world, I guess it wouldn't be perfect because I'd see him racing alongside Tony Kanaan, but in a close to perfect world, is some sort of a realistic utopia. I would like to see Sage Karam replace Tony Kanaan, because Sage Karam is the driver of the future, and Tony's days, not to pick on Tony, are behind him. But you don't see this in any other sport, do you? You don't see in football where, you know, your quarterbacks who have been around for 15 years are, I don't want to say hurting the sport of football, but preventing young talent from breaking through the sport. Talent in other sports, because it's not tied to things like money and fielding a racing budget and marketing. You know, if you have the talent to play quarterback, you can take that veteran out. Unfortunately, IndyCar doesn't have enough clout in the marketing world, I think, for Sage Karam to get enough cash behind him. Chip Ganassi's tried everything he can do. This news really hurts, and it hurts because he's an American. It hurts because he's a brilliant driver. And it hurts because it's something we become used to in IndyCar. I'm not to ruin this Sage hot take with another hot take, but I'm over Connor Daly at this point, because it's been so long since he's been in a ride. But when Connor Daly moved over to Europe, he was somebody who looked like he had a bright future in IndyCar, and that fizzled out very much due to some of Connor's own decisions as well. But there's Connor, there's perhaps Veach. There are so many young drivers that IndyCar's had a chance to have, and they haven't been able to keep them, and that sucks no matter what spin you put on it.
A couple things. First of all, we'll kind of correct the situation with Zach Veach. Zach had a full season sponsorship going into last season, and something changed within the organization that was going to be sponsoring him in February of last year, and they had to pull back on the funds. That was a done deal, and then a business thing happened.
An IndyCar thing,
It was within the business that the situation changed. Yes, he had a full IndyCar deal, and it was just too late to come up with, you know, that type of money on, you know, 30 days notice to start the season. And once you get started, of course, and you get that far away from the typical budget process, then, you know, Zach's waiting a year, and he was very fortunate that Bilardi gave him an opportunity to come back at the Indy Lights level this year. And I think that's ultimately going to be great for him, because he'll get to run the newer car and hopefully go out and win a championship, or at least compete for the championship and kind of restart that momentum. He's got plenty of time. He's still very young. And I don't see the Sage thing. You may know more than I do on this, but I'm not so sure that Chip Ganassi tried as hard as he could. I think he tried as hard as he could, maybe up until the time that he decided to let him go. But something tells me, Joel, that there was more behind it than this. I think Sage had some really unfortunate things happen. And I think, you know, maybe, again, I feel like it might just be that either A, he'll come up with something else, or B, maybe a little bit of time off may help him to be able to put himself in a better situation to come back. I think, you know, Sage had, you know, had his opportunity. He's got a ton of talent. But, you know, obviously, he did wreck a lot of stuff, and he did, I think it sometimes having to step back allows you to more easily step forward. So I don't quite see this whole sort of, this is bad for IndyCar sort of scenario. I think you got to look at it case by case. IndyCar's got more young talent in it now than it's had in a long time, more Americans in it than it's had. Tony Kanaan may or may not still be as competitive as he was. Castro Neves certainly is shown to be. I don't want to force those veterans out just to be able to open up seats for the young guys. What I think IndyCar does need to do, though, and maybe this is where we can find some common ground here, is I think IndyCar does need to absolutely put themselves in a situation where they market their own product better to entice more sponsors to get into the sport, maybe create some of these opportunities. But I don't want to, I think we could probably do another whole segment on that, and there's a lot more to discuss, but definitely want to talk about, Phoenix. I want to talk about the scheduling. What's Phoenix look like? What's Boston looking like at this point? Update us on those things.
Apparently, Phoenix is driving similar to Iowa. There were a group of drivers who tested there. It was about 2 weeks ago, depending on when you're listening to this. And Marco Andretti was one of them, said that it's like driving Iowa. The amount of grip that they have, the load, especially the front load through the wheels. He thinks that they can have a second groove, which would, of course, be remarkable for racing.
Nice.
Yeah, so I think it would be a really fun place. James Hinchcliffe had great things to say about it. So did Carlos Munoz. They actually said it feels more like a speedway than it does its track size, which, again,
nice.
Speaks volumes. I mean, that's what you want to hear, right?
So if the mayor likes it, that's good enough for me.
Yep, everyone's been so excited about Phoenix. Between that, Road America, Boston, on the other hand, I would still like to think that race is going to come through, but it was dealt another curveball. And at this point, it just feels like a beanball because there's so many people who don't want this race to be there. Some new dangers, so to speak, and I use dangers with finger quotes when I use that word because it seems to be really bad, but I think when you break it down, it's kind of ridiculous. The Boston Convention and Exhibition Center and the Massachusetts Convention Center Authority put out a report that says that an explosion on the part that goes underground by Fargo Street, that part of the track could cause catastrophic structural damage to that area, which, on the one hand, maybe they know better than I do, but I don't know what type of explosion you could possibly be thinking of in this area. And wouldn't that be an issue when you have big 18-wheelers and all sorts of other stuff go through these tunnels? So there's that. There's the condos and the apartments that are on a couple different stretches of that track. That's where some of the most vocal opponents of this race have been. And although the details are confidential, there was supposedly a 5-year deal that was struck between IndyCar and the Seaport Lofts Condominium Association just to end their opposition to the event. So I guess that's a small step in the right direction, but this is not easy. It's like pulling teeth.
It really seems to be, and I think that's the disappointing thing. By the way, while we're talking about the New England area, Joel, I do have to rib you just a little bit in the fact that your Patriots are
now— I did
now
not put him up to this. I'm just putting that out there.
No, I know you didn't.
I could have come up.
I had to go there.
I would have planned something much better had I.
Time for a break, guys. Good to be with you. And bring food next time.
Hashtag Joel is not going there.
How dare you not bring me food, not bring me wine, and then bring that up in the end? What's wrong with you tonight?
Have a good night, Joel.
Oh, boy. I guess on his suggestion, we will take a break. We'll talk dirt in the second hour coming up after this. You're listening to The Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
Parents, your son or daughter has had their license for a while now, but you want to make sure they're prepared for any situation they may face on the road. High school driver's ed doesn't teach them to drive defensively. They need to be prepared for any highway emergency. For less than a month's insurance, and a whole lot less, BSR instructors at Summit Point Motorsports Park in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, will teach your son or daughter how to respond instantly and positively to unexpected situations on the road. BSR's specialized accident avoidance training teaches swerve to avoid maneuvers at highway speeds, ocular driving, which focuses driving attention on ways to avoid accidents, vehicle dynamics and feedback, skid control and skid recovery, threshold braking on straights and progressive braking on curves, and off-road recovery techniques. This is stuff Driver's Ed simply doesn't teach. So call BSR today, 304-725-8444. Give your kid the skill set needed to drive safely and responsibly on the highway. That's 304-725-8444.
The odds of a young girl being discovered by an industry insider while singing to herself pumping gas. 1 in 300 million. The odds of a daughter of a clergyman from Severn, Maryland, spending 11 weeks at number 1 on the U.S. singles charts. 1 and 19 million. The odds of going on to win 7 Grammy Awards? 1 in 1.4 million. The odds of selling over 40 million records? 1 in 800,000. The odds of this musician and performer having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 68. I'm Toni Braxton, and I encourage you to learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs. Early diagnosis can make a lifetime of difference. Autism Speaks. It's time to listen. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Eric Darnell.
This is David Reagan.
Jamie McMurray.
This is Carl Edwards here for RED,
the entertainment industry's voice for road safety.
Want to make a difference? It's simple. Be responsible.
Plan ahead. Designate before you celebrate.
Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
You're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network, your authority on motorsports of all types. Be listening for the most accurate and up-to-the-minute coverage of every motorsports activity that you enjoy on a daily basis. Be it NASCAR, be it IRL, be it Formula One, be it drag racing, be it dirt track, off-road, props, hulls, whatever. We are your source for motorsports. Performance Motorsports Network. Hi, the kids. It's time to get dirty on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness. Here are your hosts, Jacob, Tom, and Kyle, with Turn 5 Live's curator of Casa de Pork Chop, Stephen Oven.
And after the halftime break, we welcome you back to Motorsports Madness here on PMN. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda is off tonight, and Steve Ovens will be joining us momentarily. But before we get Steve in on the conversation, Tom, I want to roll to you and go ahead and let you get your two cents in before Steve comes in and hogs the microphone. Well, he snuck up on me. We'll just let him hog the microphone. Steve-O, make sure you give Tom his due on this subject. But let us start with the bombshell news of the day that reigning Super Dirt Car Series champ Matt Sheppard and Hanky Baldwin Racing, that marriage, done. Divorce. Goodbye.
It is. I'm going to jump in before Steve does here. And I'll jump in with my two cents and then toss to Steve. I know Steve's probably got more updated information than what I have, but this seems like a bit of a conundrum to me. This seems like there's more to it than what we know and what's on the surface. My impression of this is that there was something going on within the ranks that precipitated this, because neither side seems to be particularly happy about it. Steve-O, what say you on this? My take is this was not a split that either one of them really would have wanted, just based upon what we're hearing from other sources and the communication that's kind of gone back and forth here. But something also tells me that somehow in the end, this is going to work out better for everybody concerned, although I don't know how it gets better than the championship.
Well, that's the key to this whole thing, guys, is, you know, I don't, this is certainly unexpected. And, the interesting thing is that, you know, neither side is really talking about what's going on. You know, everybody out there, and you know, the blessing and the curse of things like social media is that everybody has an opinion, and they've not been afraid to share them. You know, over the last 24 hours since this news broke, and I think the thing is that you know, eventually, I'm sure whatever has transpired, you know, that'll all come out. That'll all work itself out. It'll all come out in the wash. But, you know, the shocking thing about it is, and I've been thinking about this all day on how, you know, what I could say about this whole situation. But I think it's unfortunate, because these guys are coming off of a season where they pulled down the company's first Super Dirt Car Series championship. You even look back to 2014, they were within one bad qualifying effort of even having two Super Dirt Car Series championships, and that would have been Matt's fifth. I mean, he now has four. And so, you know, the way that I look at this is I think, and this is my opinion, Tom, I think that this is, you know, it's unfortunate for Matt, but with Matt Sheppard's credentials, Matt Sheppard's going to land on his feet. Whether he goes to drive for somebody else or starts his own team, he now has the credentials that he's going to be able to get whatever support he needs and whatever people he needs to put around himself to land on his feet and run with a new opportunity. What I think is the negative side to this is I will be very interested to see how this impacts HBR going forward, because I'm sorry, and I have nothing against the team. I have nothing against their driver. I feel like this is going to be an unfortunate step backwards for them, because Matt Sheppard, and it said right in the Hanky Baldwin Racing press release today that Matt Sheppard brought a level of intensity to that team that they had not seen in previous years and brought them to a level that they had not competed at in their tenure in the sport.
Steve, do you it said in the press release that it basically stated, and I don't have it in front of me, that due to the increased need to focus on Weed Sport Speedway, they were going to drop to a one-car team with Jimmy Phelps at the wheel. Are you buying or selling that? Because I gotta tell you, I don't. And again, this is just a gut. But I don't believe that when the season starts in 2016, I don't believe there's going to be just one car in that stable. I really don't.
Well, I'm not. As far as what the press release reads, I really don't think that it's going to be a two-car team. Now, that's not to say
you
that
don't?
It won't. I don't. I think that they have chosen the road they're going to go down now. Now, I will say this. When I read the press release this morning, do I think that they need to go down to a two-car team to focus their efforts on Weed Sport Speedway? And Tom, I thought you were asking me if I was going to buy or sell that. And if you were to pose that question to me, I'd sell that all day long. Because look what they've done with Weed Sport Speedway with a two-car operation.
Well, that's kind of my point, and that really was the point of this is that I don't believe the reason, first of all. And I don't believe they're going to stay a one-car team. I really don't. But you're saying you do. You're saying you believe that they will stay a one-car team.
Well, I mean, anything can happen. I mean, yesterday proved it. Anything can happen and will happen. But I really think that there would be some, you know, I really think they would really take some negative flack from the fans. And you know, at the end of the day, you know, the fan support, you know, with these teams and things like that are maybe not as crucial as it is in a larger scale sport like NASCAR.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I really think that with what they've said in the press release today, I really think that they've kind of chosen the road they're going to go down. And it sounds like that's going to be with a one car team. Now, certainly, you have to look at the situation and say, well, wow, you know, that leaves a ride open for, well, let's see, a young driver out of North Carolina that just, you know, had some pretty impressive starts, you know, in Max McLaughlin. Now, one would think, well, you've got a whole fleet of cars, you've got, you know, transporter, team support, whatever you need there and available, so that makes sense. But when I read the press release today, I just get the impression that, you know, they've made this decision, and I feel like one car team is the road they're going to go down. And you know, it'd be interesting to see what develops out of this.
It will.
Because, yeah, I mean, it would make sense, but
I've just learned not to believe everything I read, and we'll leave it there for right now. And I don't know if it would be Max. I just, something about the one car thing doesn't strike me as ringing true. It may be one car now, but we'll see what happens next couple months. We got a long off season yet.
All right. So I'll shift gears on this subject for a second, Steve-O. You said that you'd believe that Matt Shepard is going to land quite squarely on his feet for 2016. Where, pray tell, are you taking him, and why are you taking him the direction that you are?
Well, I look at this situation, and the thing that people are going, they're going right to, right straight away is, oh, Matt Shepard's out at HBR. He's going to Gypsum. He's going to be driving a red car for the rest of his career. And
that's a good rumor.
Well, it is. And that's where the fans are going. That's the first place they're going. And I'm saying, hold on, folks, pump the brakes a little bit here. They are very solid over there with Larry White, Pat Ward, Billy Decker. Now, the rumor mill had fired up about Decker potentially not being in a Gypsum car in the future. But even at that, I still think that I don't see any scenario where Matt Shepard goes to Gypsum.
I don't either.
I don't see that happening.
I said it was a good rumor and say I believed it.
Oh yeah, it is for sure. But Jacob, to answer your question, this is what I see. I see Matt Shepard going the way of a driver like Brett Hearn. And look at all the success that Brett has had. Brett has always been, I mean, he's driven for some owners over the course of his career, but right now he is very, very successful as a one-car team. I see Matt Shepard starting his own deal. And again, this is all speculative at this point, and we'll learn more over the offseason. But I think that with his credentials, he's a four-time Super Dirt Car Series champion. He's a former winner of the Syracuse 200. He has won countless championships at all of the weekly races, weekly tracks that he's competed at. He's got all the credentials he needs to go out and get support from Bicknell Racing Products. Now, Matt has always been, other than when he drove for Hanky Baldwin Racing, he was always a Bicknell guy. And I see Matt going back to Bicknell. Now, and as far as engines, as far as components, you name it, shocks, he's got the credentials that he could go and get a major sponsor. He's carried FX Caprera Chevy for several years now. I don't see any reason why Matt can't go get a major sponsor, do his own deal, and be just as competitive, if not better, than he was at HBR.
I would agree with that. We'll talk more about that and other things dirt track when we return. You are listening to Motorsports Madness here on a Monday night on the Performance Motorsports Network.
I'm NASCAR driver Bobby Labonte. At 200 miles per hour, many unseen dangers can arise in the blink of an eye. That's why we have spotters high above the track. They help drivers avoid trouble. Parents need to play the same role when it comes to kids and computers. As a parent, I know the internet can take kids to wonderful sites for learning, entertainment, and fun, but it can also lead to danger.
Here are some safety tips. Keep the computer in a family area where you can see it. Proactively teach your children never to share personal information online.
My turn.
Become knowledgeable about signing on to websites, searching for information, and using email and instant messaging. Doing so will help you recognize potential dangers. Familiarize yourself with safer websites and post that list by your computer.
Like our spotters, parents are best positioned to see the dangers kids could face online and to help them avoid them. Make a commitment to keeping kids safe online.
A message from WebWise Kids and Ask.com.
You own a performance car and you know how to drive, but you want to learn real performance driving. Well, Bunky, get that car off the street and onto the track. Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier road racing facility, located just over an hour from D.C. in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, is the place to go. And you'll find that Friday at the track is going to give you what you need. For less than a monthly car payment, you can attend this regularly scheduled one-day instructional event in your streetcar on one of Summit Point's three world-class road racing circuits. You'll receive classroom instruction, skid pad instruction in their cars, including
front and rear skid control, and 4 20-minute in-your-car instructional sessions from a professional instructor. Have fun, go fast, and really learn how to drive. Call 304-725-8444 for class schedules and details. That's 304-725-8444. Friday at the track at Summit Point Motorsports Park.
Travel is part of the American way of life.
When we're on vacation, we keep an eye out for anything that looks out of place.
Miss your bag.
When we travel from city to city, we pay attention to our surroundings.
Everyone plays a role in keeping our community safe.
Whether you're traveling for business or pleasure, be aware of your surroundings. If you see something suspicious, say something to local authorities.
Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne. For many years, you know I've had a drink problem and I'm trying to battle that problem every single day. But one thing I don't do, I don't drive my car when I'm drinking. I get someone to drive me. Do not drink and drive. It's the stupidest thing. If you drink, just don't drive. Not only are you going to hurt yourself, you may hurt some other person, and you wouldn't want that on your conscience, would you?
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Time to get back to tonight's Motorsports Madness. Here are the only three of a kind that beat the full house. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
And welcome back to the Madness here on PMN. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker with you at the roundtable. Kyle Magda is off tonight. And alongside Steve Ovens from Turn 5 Live, we're talking dirt right now on the Madness. And Steve-O, we've been talking all about Matt Sheppard in this prior segment here. But, you know, we look at the rest of this season, the way it's played out. Y'all had a pretty fun little race over Thanksgiving weekend that I want to give some props to up at Black Rock. I believe, you know, we talk about turkeys and think, hey, we get to sit at home and eat food. Not when there's racing to be done, man.
Oh, yeah. And Mother Nature gave us a run for our money on Saturday when we tried to get the event in. So I had to hold it over onto a rain date on Sunday. Completed the event yesterday, and one of our modified stars, Ron Cartwright Jr., picked up the big win in the Open Sportsman versus Crate Sportsman division. That was the headline division for the day, and it was such an interesting event. All the different creations. It was a run what you brung style event.
Oh,
and
wow.
The winning car had it was a Sportsman modified. So if you're familiar with the Northeast Dirt modifieds, imagine them taking the tops of the quarter panels off and strapping a full-size sprint car wing to the roof, and that was the winning combination yesterday. So
I'm having fun just trying to picture this right now. This is fantastic.
Well, if you haven't had a chance to see it, take a look. We've got a picture posted on go to facebook.com/BlackRockSpeedway or search on Facebook Black Rock Speedway. We've got a great photo in the cover photo that shows the car at speed in the corner. And it's also shown with a dirt modified that had the sail panels on. So you had two different variations of body styles yesterday that guys were trying to use, and it was a unique event and a great way to wrap up 2015.
Yeah, it sounds like it was a lot of fun, Steve. And you know, as we talk about starting to wrap up 16 here, I want to now kind of talk to you and give you a few minutes of space here to discuss 2015. Looking back, I'll give you some space, some time to do this. Pick out, if you can for me, your best three moments from across the Northeast Dirt season. I don't care what division, what series, and I know this is going to make it difficult for you, but I'm curious what stuck out.
Oh, boy. Well, I think probably the top moment had to be the finale at the fairgrounds as we closed out the history of Super Dirt Week at the Moody Mile. That was an event that got all of the due media and you know, all of the necessary
praise.
Yes, praise. I mean, and it got all of the things they did from bringing all of the past champions that they could get to the fairgrounds that day, and they got a lot of them. To have Buzzy Rudiman there and David Rudiman there all weekend to participate in the fun. And, you know, then to have the race event over, Stuart Friesen wins another one. And then to see everybody just kind of hanging out on the last night, everybody around their campfires, people out digging up pieces of the track, putting them in jars to take home with them, which I, by the way, have my jar of the Moody Mile in
there
hand.
You go.
So, you know, I think that was a top moment for sure. I think, you know, and ironically enough, we were just talking about this. I think Matt Shepard delivering a championship to Hanky Baldwin, you know, Al Hanky and that whole team has done so much for the sport, not only as team owner, but with everything that they have done with Weed Sport Speedway. I mean, they have just revitalized that whole speedway. So I think that would be on the list too. And boy, it's for another top moment. I mean, boy, it's looking back over the course of the whole season. I mean, there was so many. You know, I guess I'd put up here too is after the tragedy and the strife that Canandaigua Motorsports Park went through in 2014, I think it was great for them to kind of get back on even ground, continue on under the leadership of Jeremy and Lori Corcoran. It seems that they have a stable future going forward there at Canandaigua. And I think for everything that, you know, the ownership, the promoters and the fans and the drivers at that speedway went through, for them to kind of get back on level ground and carry on doing, you know, what they love to do, I think that was huge this year.
All right, so now I'll shift gears on you for a second, and Tom, I'll pose the same question to you, since you pay a lot of attention to this too, originally being from New York. Can you give us a couple of your top moments, anything that may not overlap with Steve per se?
Well, I actually liked all of the Steve's, but I know you said Central New York, but if you expand it out and just kind of cover Northeast in general, I think Stuart Friesen's outlaw win has to be.
Yes, please.
You know, that has to be in there somewhere. You know, there were so many, as Steve said, so many really nice moments this year. And even just, you know, again, Max McLaughlin going up. I know this isn't, you know, a huge deal probably on the scale that it may eventually get to be, but, you know, that because Mike McLaughlin is so revered up there and was from there, to have Max go back and get into a Troyer 6 replica car and, you know, do those sorts of things. I think, I certainly think the fairgrounds had to be number one. You know, I like everything Steve said. I will ask Steve this question. Looking ahead to 2016, with the Dirt Series being where it is, Super Dirt Car Series with the ROC Series coming on, and of course, you still have the Short Track Super Series, where do you see the biggest changes, the biggest leaps, gains, where do you see the landscape being you know, when we get into the 2016 season, what are your projections?
Well, I think that I think as far as the Short Track Super Series goes, I'll start with Brett Deo's series. I think those guys will pretty much stay status quo next year. Brett is pretty committed to making sure that that's not a 26 race series. He really gears that toward the working racer, the guy that, you know, can't travel to 26 races, but, you know, has enough vacation time where he can go to 7-8 special shows over the summer. So I don't think there'll be a ton of change there. They have a great equation there. seven to eight races that all pay very, very well all the way through the field. So I think you say much of the same there. I didn't think that the Super Dirt Car Series would necessarily see any major changes, but then you insert in Matt Shepard finding a new home, and now you also have them going to Eldora for the Midsummer Classic.
Yes.
And a stop, Jacob, at Sharon Speedway.
Yes.
And so you put that together and you're like, wow, this is really going to be a standout year for the Super Dirt Car Series. But I'll say this, guys, and Tom, I know that this is something that will perk your ears because, you know, this is a story that we've all kind of been talking about. Is I think the biggest change is going to come with the ROC Dirt Series. And although we don't exactly know what that all is going to look like just yet, there's going to be a lot of people that are going to be sitting back and waiting for all of those announcements to come out to see,
what
this is going to look like. Is it going to be much different than what we've seen? Because me personally, I think we're going to see something out of that series that is completely different than what has operated as for the past couple of years.
I agree. I think maybe, and if not, if that doesn't all happen at once in 16, I think over a couple of year period, it will. I think Joe Scott Nicky has got big plans for it. And I think there's more than enough room for all three of those series to coexist nicely up there.
No doubt about it. And I think that's the great thing for the sport right now. Is you have all these different options, and for the most part, these guys do a pretty good job of everybody having their own corner of the sandbox. And with the changes coming to ROC, I don't know what that's going to look like, but really, at the end of the day, the winners are the drivers and the fans. And hey, I'll throw the media guys in there too.
Absolutely.
Woo, we're all excited about this. And by the way, Steve-O, before we cut you loose tonight, we do keep in mind that we want to have you keep your ears to the dirt for the next couple of weeks because, hey, we got two more Mondays before we go off for Christmas, and there's got to be some more news to dig up somewhere.
Well, I mean, we didn't have to do much digging to get news this week, so we'll see what happens next week, guys.
Dropped right in our lap.
Yeah, it did. With that, we will step away for a moment to do some business, come back, and we've still got a half hour more of conversation to have, so we'll continue with Motorsports Madness right after this. You are listening to the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports.
In 50 feet, turn left. Why are you driving so slowly?
After a few drinks, I'm taking it slow.
Well, you're not fooling the cop behind you.
What?
Get ready to pay in 0.1 miles.
Getting pulled over for buzz driving could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
This is Paul Stanley from Kiss for Rad, recording artists, actors, and athletes against drunk driving. Some of us work months producing a CD, but in less time than it takes to play it, someone will be killed in an alcohol-related crash. So please don't drive when you've been drinking. Plan ahead. Arrange a designated driver. Remember, friends don't let friends drive drunk.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
You're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network, your authority on motorsports of all types. Be listening for the most accurate and up-to-the-minute coverage of every motorsports activity that you enjoy on a daily basis. Be it NASCAR, be it IRL, be it Formula One, be it drag racing, be it dirt track, off-road, props, hulls, whatever. We are your source for motorsports. Performance Motorsports Network.
This is Joey Logano, driver of NASCAR number 22 Discount Tire Car. You know something? You and I aren't all that different. I drive a car, you drive a car. My car has tires, your car has tires. I may be going just a little faster than you each weekend, but we both need to keep those tires properly inflated to stay safe. So be tire smart and do your part. Check your tire pressures once a month and before every long journey.
Visit BeTireSmart.org. A message from the Rubber Manufacturers Association.
We now return you to 2.5 Men on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
Q1.5, because Kyle Magna is off tonight. I can adjust my math on the fly. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker here at the round table, talking a little track racing for a minute since, well, that was about all that was going on over the weekend. There are two things we will discuss in this segment that we will undoubtedly return to in more detail later on in the week, but I will throw you first this from Southern National Motorsports Park, right down the road in Eastern North Carolina, a couple hours. The one race that Lee Pulliam has not won in his late model stock car career, the Thanksgiving All-Star Classic 200 on Sunday afternoon, he won. Maybe not such a surprise after the year he's had, Tom, was in the hospital on Thanksgiving Day after a car accident that left her with a shattered leg, a shattered hip, and you know she undergoes all the casts and setting of everything to be in place and says, doggone it, I'm going to the racetrack to be there because I have this feeling he's going to win on Sunday. She's discharged Sunday morning. She's at the track Sunday afternoon. And what does Lee Pulliam do? He makes the pass for the lead before halfway and holds it the rest of the distance. Wins the Thanksgiving Classic for the first time with arguably one of the best stories of the year. I love it. I'm not usually a Lee Pulliam fan, but as Myatt Snyder said after finishing second, he thought everybody was a little bit of a Lee Pulliam fan yesterday.
Well, and that is a great story. I mean, anytime that you can, anytime you have a triumph over tragedy story, it's a great story. And Lee, for those who aren't familiar, is how many time NASCAR champion now?
Three times, including four, this year.
You know, Lee is one of the top short trackers in the country. And, you know, anytime you have a situation, I mean, Thanksgiving is about the worst time, to have something like what happened to his wife happen and for her to have the injuries that she had and to be able to leave the hospital and then get to the track and then lead to be able to conquer a race that had his number for a number of
about
years.
About 4 years in
a
row before this year.
You know, that's... It's just, again, it's a Hollywood script story. And I think that at the end of the day, he really is going to be inspired by this. And, you know, the holiday weekend, that's what it's for. It's a big stage.
Oh, yeah.
It's got special, you know, events. And you love to hear stories like this. Certainly our best to Lee and his wife. And, you know, hope she has a quick recovery from mm-hmm. her injuries. But this was a great story for sure. And congratulations to Lee on a big win in a race that's always a great Thanksgiving Day weekend race that I think was made better this year, even, by some of the things that Mike Diaz is doing now at Southern National.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's been a great facility this year. And
it has.
You know, I want to give Myatt some props, too. I don't think we talk enough about the job that he's done this year and really the last couple of months to have come on so strong with a win in what is now the UNOH battle at the beach.
Yes.
Traditionally been the Myrtle Beach 400. 100. But what, you know, what a job that young man has done over the past couple of months to get his program where it needs to be. He's been in contention in the final Cars Tour races of the year. He won the battle at the beach, the Myrtle Beach 400, and, you know, to finish second to Lee Pulley, I mean, in any race, but of in a race like this that's one of the four crown jewels of late model stock car racing, you can't be ashamed at that. And this is the most together I've seen that team and my himself, honestly, behind the wheel. I think in his entire short track career to date, he looks like a different driver now than he did the last couple of years. And I like it. I like where he's headed for next year. He's got some momentum.
Well, he does. I don't know that, honestly, that Myatt himself really changed very much this year. I just think his luck did. You know, he's been a strong runner in the late models for a couple of years now. You know, this year it just seems like he's had the luck to be able to, you know, be in the position to win the races. And he's really, Myatt's just a super kid. Of course, you know, his father, Marty, a great TV broadcaster. You know, he's, Myatt's a very unassuming kid. And he's, you know, he's not a kid that's going to spend a lot of time talking about himself. You know, he just likes to get in the car and go do his job. You know, and he really does well at it, you know, and he's, you're right, he's had a good last couple of months. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to win in Myrtle Beach, that's another one of those races that is just, it's god-awful hard to win. And then to come back and have a strong run again this past weekend at Southern National, you know, he certainly is, you're right, the momentum is certainly on his side to come out and have a spectacular 2016. And I certainly hope he will, because he deserves that. He's, it says, a super kid, and he's worked real hard at the racing in a very quiet way over, you know, the last good number of years.
And then I want to shift back up to the Northeast for a minute. And again, we can talk about more in depth about this a little bit later on in the week on the Stock Car Steel SRI Motorsports show. But, you know, talking about the Turkey Derby as well, and the six of Ryan Preece going to victory lane in that race after a rain delay and chaos and Doug Coby coming back through the field to finish top five. But it may, you know, this could be the swan song. We still don't know if Eddie Partridge is bringing that team back next year. No better way to go out than on top.
Yeah, and what is this with modified teams going away? I mean, this is...
I know, what's the deal? Is, our motorsports is gone, and by the way, Buzz Chew's gone. They're going to the dirt in 16. Speaking, Tom, by the way, of the our motorsports team going away, their assets were bought by the Sully Tineo-owned team. So Bobby Santos now has the 20... They'll re-wrap it for next year, but they have... The 44 teams got all those cars and equipment, a whole fleet.
They can put on their own series.
I'm not so sure about
run
that.
Run all the cars now. But. Yeah, that's I think a series of odd coincidences there. But, you know, we definitely hope that Eddie Partridge keeps the six intact, and whether Ryan is going to drive it or not, you know, obviously – I'm sure Ryan would like to be a NASCAR full-time somewhere in that National Series equation. But I also think that, you know, he would still like to be racing some modifieds as well. And if he can't race the car, I hope they'll look at, you know, putting someone else in it. You know, there are certainly a couple of good shoes available with Woody Pitcat's feet in him. So, you know, it'll be interesting to see where he lands. But yeah, that was a big win for Ryan, and you know, he hasn't been able to win. Yeah, that's one of those races that Ryan, you know, as he said, it's one of those you want to win. And, he feels like, you know, the cautions kind of went his way in that one this year with, as you said, Coby having the issue and Matt Hirschman. But, you know, Ryan did a great job to pick up that win. And that's another one of those iconic race weekends.
Yeah.
Wall Stadium's a neat track in New Jersey. If somebody's up in that area and hasn't gone, you should. It's a great little track to go to.
Oh, it is fun. And, you know, there's a lot of change in the modified ranks for next year, too. When you stop and think about that, another subject that we can get more into over the coming weeks, but the fact that, you know, I was just talking about the Sully Tenio team with Bobby Santos, the 44 for next year, and Andy Seiss and Eddie Harvey's team, the 11 here down south, switching to LFR chassis for 2016. And after seeing what Doug Kobe did with them, I love that change.
Well, you know, that's I think that's going to be very interesting to watch. You know, Andy and Eddie are great people, and Andy's an amazing racer. You know, I can certainly see that playing all kinds of havoc with the Southern Modified Tour down here.
Oh, boy.
You know, I mean, again, they just never quit trying to win championships.
No, they don't. I mean, they're going for, what, three straight? And I told Eddie Harvey when I saw him at the final race at Charlotte last month, Tom, that I thought a three-peat from them seeing what they've done was certainly capable. And he looked at me and he goes, bring it on. Let's go.
Yeah, and that, you know, that enthusiasm's good. And the Southern Tour is certainly healthy right now with great competition. You know, Andy didn't dominate the tour by any stretch of the imagination this year. But again, he was good enough to stay in contention and, you know, and win it when he needed to win it. So going to be fun to watch him in an LFR car next year. For sure. That's kind of the new three-word acronym in modifieds, isn't it? LFR.
Yeah. Well, three letters.
Three letters. Sorry, not three words. It's Tom, Monday.
It's Monday and Tom can't grammar at the moment. Anyway. We'll be back for the last call right after this. We'll get the white flag out, and we'll roll to conclusion tonight here on Motorsports Madness and see if we don't need to put Tom in a straitjacket before that. You're listening to the Madness here on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
Okay, so Sarah, I'm dropping you off at Emily's?
Yep.
And Josh, you're going to?
Soccer, Dad. Soccer practice.
Right. Oh, by the way, I just wanted to let you know when I pick you both up, I'll be wearing my short shorts.
What?
No!
Yep, and my dorky dad hat, and I'm gonna do my dad dance for all your friends. They'll love it!
Seriously? Why?
Because I like my short shorts. Of course, I could be talked out of it if you guys would just buckle up your seatbelts without giving me a hard time.
It's important to get your kids to buckle up for safety, no matter what it takes. And sometimes, all it takes is your parental powers of persuasion.
Okay, we're buckling up.
See, all buckled.
Good choice. I'll just have to do my dad dance at dinner time.
What?
No!
Do what you have to make sure your kids are wearing their seatbelts, even on short drives. Never give up until they buckle up. A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council. Visit safercar.gov/kidsbuckleup for more information.
If you're a gearhead and you just can't get enough of your favorite motorsports on that channel on the cable, or you look at that Guy Network and you just go, what does that have to do with me? We have the answer. Performance Motorsports Network. Right here on the internet. The best cruising tunes, the best in motorsports programming, and the best shows. We have opinionated hosts, and we like it that way. If you want to get involved, if you want to bench race, be listening for information coming up soon right here on this channel, the Performance Motorsports Network, your source for motorsports. You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
We are back here with the final 15 minutes of Motorsports Madness tonight. Our last call or white flag segment, whatever your fancy here, is you're listening to us on PMN. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda is off tonight, and it's now the off season, Tom, which means it's time for my famous chant at the end of every regular season. Cue silly season, stage left. We got that over the past couple of days. Couple of high profile crew chief moves. Firstly, new man on the totem pole in the 42 camp for Chip Ganassi and Kyle Larson. Hello, Chad Johnston. Welcome aboard.
Yeah, this part of a wholesale move by Stuart Haas to improve where they thought they needed to. Chad, of course, has been the crew chief for Tony Stewart for the past couple of seasons after being plucked from Michael Waltrip Racing. And I think, honestly, if you were to ask me if I buy or sell that this helps Kyle Larson break through and, you know, get to the winner's circle and maybe take another step forward, I would absolutely buy it. And I think that him leaving Tony should not be constituted as Tony saying that Chad wasn't doing the job. I think quite the opposite. I think Chad had an opportunity. I think Tony thought it was great for him, and he went and pulled the car chief, Buck Buggerwitz.
Race engineer.
The engineer from the four car. And promoted him to crew chief. Look, here's the situation. I think this really is this, along with making the change on top of Danica's box and replacing
Daniel Canost
with Billy Scott
from the 55 team.
Another pluck from Michael Waltrip Racing, but which is good.
Not really.
Well, it's good for him, obviously, and I hope all of those guys find opportunities to work once the season, or now that the season's over, because, you know, that's the unfortunate thing about whenever a team shuts down. You know, we can say what we will about, you know, the team, and they, you know, kind of help their own demise or whatever, but there's a lot of individuals that work on those teams and have to feed their families. So I think this is going to be great for all parties. I certainly think, you know, Tony needed a change. I think the new package for next year, I really believe, is going to benefit Tony. I don't know that I'm ready to say that I think Tony runs for the championship, but I certainly think that he's capable. And I think, again, I could certainly see him winning a race. You know, these cars are going to drive a lot more like he wanted them to, and a lot more like he was used to. So I think Tony will have a good season. And I think Chad going over to Chip Ganassi to work with Kyle Larson, if you think about it, Kyle Larson, in the way he drives the car, mm-hmm. very much like a young Tony Stewart.
Yeah.
So I really honestly think that this actually may end up looking like it should have looked with Tony, but I think Chad and Tony got together really just, you know, unfortunately, after they got together, you know, Tony just has had that ongoing series of, you know, situations happen with the injury, and then, you know, everything with the sprint car situation and all of that. It's just been a very tough time for Tony.
Tony Stewart rebound in 2016 and look like the old Tony Stewart?
Well, that's what I was saying. I don't know that I'm ready to say that he's, you know, going to be equivalent to Kevin Harvick, but I definitely think that he has the chance to win a race, and by doing that, get into the chase. The new package, I think, is going to benefit him. So I think that he's going to have somebody new up on top of the pit box, but who came is still was in the organization. So there shouldn't be a lot of struggles with chemistry, because, you know, Bug was already in the organization with Kevin Harvick when he won the title. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, as far as the Danica crew chief, you know, I think that probably it comes down to a situation where probably Ganost wanted a change and wanted maybe to come off the road crew chiefs get into those situations after a while where they just get tired of the travel. And that's, I think, a lot of times when you see them end up being promoted within the group, with the organization, but to a higher up position where they don't have to be at all the tracks. Billy Scott will certainly get an opportunity to get some good experience crew chiefing at the cup level in the Stuart Haas organization. And, you know, Danica gets somebody that's been there already, you know, with the 55 car. So she's not getting a new crew chief.
Yeah. She's not getting somebody that's wet behind the ears.
Right. She's getting somebody that, with experience just from a different organization. So, you know, that hopefully will minimize the learning curve between Billy and Danica, and can at least keep Danica at the level she's at and maybe possibly take her up a little bit of a step down the road as well.
Interesting. All right. So, you know, we're running towards the end of 2015. Obviously, the major part of the national scene is over, and I want to start looking back a little bit as well as looking ahead. With the conclusion of 2015, I want to look at the truck series because I feel like this was one of the most intriguing pots of drivers and scenarios and of anything we had all year long. I want you to give me one thing or driver, you know, one situation or driver that you feel like overachieved, a situation or driver you wanted a little bit more out of, and then a situation or driver that's going to be new for 2016 that you're really excited about. I know I threw a lot at you.
No, I was thinking about overachieved. I think definitely Daniel Hemric and NTS. I don't think anybody would have expected Daniel Hemric to have the season he had. I think that Daniel
is it disappointing for it or wrong for me to wish that the champion couldn't receive Rookie of the Year honors in that case? Because gosh darn, Daniel deserves it. I feel like just from where he started the season to where he ended the season. I mean, there's no denying that Erik Jones. What? You know, but I just,
well,
you know,
it is what it is. I mean, yeah, I certainly wouldn't have expected NASCAR to make a last-minute change to the rule just because the rookie happened to win the championship. I also could see a scenario where that starts happening more and more as we get the level of talent coming in.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the level of talent that's coming up through the ranks because of the way, you know, things are being done now at the K&N and ARCA level. The level of talent by the time it gets into the trucks and it, you know, especially with Kyle Busch now seeming to be wanting to focus more on the younger drivers than on himself driving in that series. You know, I think you could see more of that, but I think Daniel certainly overachieved. I think, you know, a lot of us who followed Daniel from, you know, his beginnings saw the talent, but to expect this kind of a season, especially even, you know, going to Eldora and doing what he did in the dirt race with no dirt experience before. So I think question one, I think he was the one that overachieved he was one that I believe probably overachieved, exceeded expectations. I think, also I'll skip to question three. I think that's for 2016. That's,
I knew you were,
you know,
going
I
that.
Think that's where, yeah, I think you got to tie those two together. Daniel going to Brett Keselowski Racing to team with Tyler Reddick is going to be a very dangerous combination for the rest of the truck series, I think, because those two together are just gonna I think really push each other and encourage each other, and I just think that has the chance to be great things. Mm-hmm. Underachieved, wow. That's a really interesting question. The first name that came to mind was Timothy Peters.
Until he won two races?
Yeah, I mean, you know, for most of the season, he wasn't really a factor.
I'll throw you a name that I thought of when I asked you that question, just because he usually does far more than what he ended up doing, even though he did, again, finish fourth in points, Johnny Sauter.
Well, you know, I would agree.
From a statistical standpoint.
Yeah,
though.
Maybe. Though I, you know, I just, the if you look at that, the history of that that team and Johnny together as a whole. I mean, it really has been all about Matt Crafton for the most part. You know, I think it's going to be very interesting to see who goes to the 98 this time for next year and see if that changes anything. It's almost like you just get the sense that that truck just never quite, it had its moments, and whether you attribute it to Johnny or attribute it to the chemistry or whatever the situation, but I think, you know, obviously Crafton contended for the title, and I think Cameron Haley, considering his level of experience when he got to the series at such a young age, I think Cameron probably also met or exceeded expectations. And, you know, with the 13 truck, the 98 was the one that kind of left us scratching our heads a little bit, mm-hmm. and wondering, you know, why isn't this truck winning more and why isn't it contending for wins more? We'll see what happens. We'll see who new comes into that. We'll see what happens with Johnny when he goes over to Spencer Gallagher. That was an interesting move, I thought, for 2016. We'll see what happens as a result.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting to see. While we're talking about, you know, looking back and looking ahead, and we were talking rookies a minute ago, I want to shift gears a second to back to the Cup Series. And I will say this, because I said it, gosh, beginning of March, I think, when we had our show after Brett Moffitt finished eighth at Atlanta, and I was hoping for more from him. I was a little disappointed to see him end up getting Rookie of the Year in the Cup Series, though thankful it was him than some of the other guys that were officially declared in the pot this year. I'm also very thankful that NASCAR announced earlier this week that Ryan Blaney will be eligible for Rookie of the Year in 2016. So what you've already got on the table is Ryan Blaney versus Chase Elliott for Rookie of the Year, as well as both of them fighting to make the chase in their first full-time season. Can we say there's better storylines than that?
Does it get even better if Ty Dillon comes up and goes full-time Cup?
It's possible. The catch would be he would have to declare for points in the Cup Series, and he's already basically said he's running a full season of Xfinity.
Oh, he did? Okay, I didn't see that.
He
okay.
knows that. He may run both series, but it's a matter of which series he declares for. That's the key.
Okay.
There's also the potential that Brian Scott becomes a Rookie of the Year candidate if Front Row ends up going to Chevrolet, Tom, and has that RCR alliance. There's a big rumor going around that Brian Scott goes into one of those cars.
That's I've heard that rumor, actually, and that also would open up the possibility that Ty Dillon floats into that equation that we've been discussing for a little while. Where does Ty fit? And we keep focusing on the 33 car. If Front Row were to make the jump to Chevy, and that were to all come about, you could certainly have mm-hmm. a wholesale driver swap around in those cars, and you've got at least three there that would then in theory could be available, so you could fit both Brian and Ty. But I, you know, it's very interesting to look at the Rookie of the Year picture for next year after this year's Rookie of the Year picture being kind of so dismal. None of them really. I had thought I had thought Moffitt would do a better job, you know, over the course of the year. He really didn't. You know, he was kind of the beast of the least. You know, yeah. If you want to say that, I didn't think any of the rookies were very impressive. So, you know, next year is going to be much different. Two high profile rookies, at least, and maybe as many as four. And that could be a very interesting rookie chase all the way through the year, considering the people, the teams around them. That could be a lot of fun to watch, very much reminiscent of Matt Kenseth and Dale Jr. Back a ways.
Yeah, it's going to be very I like all of this that we're playing out right here. And the best part about it is we get to come back next Monday and do it all over again.
Well, you know, it's and each week I think you're going to have, this is one of those silly seasons. I'm not even still totally convinced that we're quite done, even on the Cup side. Something tells me there's one more shocker out there somewhere that we don't know about yet.
Are you saying that you have a suspicion as to what it is? Or
no, I just feel like there's something else coming. I may be completely off base, but it feels like there's one or two, you know, good name drivers, talents that are kind of, well, geez, we don't really know. You know, the Regan Smiths are out there. I just feel like there may be one more release or parting of the ways somewhere that we aren't ready for or weren't looking for. So we'll have to see what the next few weeks bring.
Fair enough. And with that, we are going to tie a bow on tonight's edition of Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. We want to thank all of you out there that have clicked in, tuned in, and listened to us talk motorsports tonight for 2 hours. And we hope you'll do it every Monday night here on PMN, 7 p.m. Eastern. We also want to promote that the Thursday night Stock Car Steel SRI Motorsports Show, where we talk short tracks, late models, modifieds, you name it, it's probably on there.
ARCA, K&N.
Yeah, all that stuff. 7 p.m. Eastern every Thursday night here on the network. And Steve Ovens, who you heard earlier tonight, Turn 5 Live every Tuesday night at 7:30 p.m. Eastern right here on PMN. We run the whole gamut, and we like it that way. So right now, for Tom, Big Mike behind the glass, Steve, Joel, the rest of our Race Chaser Online and PMN crew that keeps it going every week without fail, I'm Jacob Seelman, reminding you to keep it off the wall until we meet again. And if you're going to be at a racetrack, we might just see you there. Have a safe racing weekend. We'll be back soon. Good night.
You've been listening to Motorsports Madness with the Speed 77 Radio Race Chaser Online crew. Stay tuned to Performance Motorsports Network for more race talk. For the latest motorsports news, visit racechaseronline.com. Motorsports Madness is a copyrighted production of the Performance Motorsports Network. www.performancemotorsportsnetwork.com. A member of the Scorpion Radio Group, Inc. and may not be rebroadcast, replicated, or saved in any media without the explicit written permission of PMN. Check out our Facebook page or our section on the PMN website. The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host, co-host, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of the management and ownership of either the Performance Motorsports Network or Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated, the advertisers, or the marketing partners. Be listening again next week when the madness returns on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Until then, keep it off the wall and keep the shiny side up.